The ancient Saint Port of Hythe stands at the gateway to Kent's historic Romney Marsh. Over the years, it's had an interesting association with several very different forms of transport. Lionel Lukin, the inventor of the lifeboat, lived here, as did Sir Francis Pettit Smith, whose work on the steam screw propeller is commemorated by this plaque in the High Street. For many years, it was possible to travel by horse tram between Hythe and neighbouring Sandgate, and even today, over 70 years since its closure, memories of the line linger on at the old Red Lion Square depot. Running through the town is the Royal Military Canal. Built in 1805 as a line of both defence and transportation between Hythe and Rye, this famous old waterway has now been turned over to the modern joys of boating and fishing. And it's alongside the canal at Scanlan's Bridge where our journey begins, because here is the Hythe terminus of the world's only miniature mainline railway, the Romney, Hythe and Dymchurch. Hythe station has undergone a few changes since it opened in 1927. Passengers once had to queue in the rain for tickets, but now there's an attractive booking hall and waiting area. The station is the only real terminus on the line, and it's equipped with a large turntable, where Southern Maid, one of the railway's 11 steam locomotives, is being turned in readiness for the journey to Dungeness. While the signalman does the hard work, the driver checks the axle boxes and bearings to make sure nothing is running hot. Back in the box, the signalman sets the road before coupling the engine back onto the train. Hythe signal box hasn't changed very much since it opened in 1927, although now it controls a mixture of both traditional semaphore and modern colour light signals. With the signal set to clear, the train starts on its 13.5 mile journey to Dungeness. Just after leaving the station, the train negotiates a new section of track known as the Hythe Deviation. This resulted from the railway's decision to sell the existing track bed to a company building a new business park. In one of the biggest civil engineering projects undertaken by the railway, a new deviating line was constructed alongside the canal. Plate layers, the first test train was able to run over the new upline in November 1989, just in time for that year's Santa specials. Consisted of 15 coaches and the bar car, was hauled by Hercules with assistance from Northern Chief. As the new formation hadn't been ballasted or levelled, a temporary 5 mile an hour speed limit had to be observed over the deviation during the Santa specials. Today the old track bed is overgrown and used by walkers with their dogs. Alongside, the new deviation looks as if it's always been there. Soon new factory units will be built and views like this will become a memory. Onward from the deviation, the line runs between the houses of West Hythe towards the Prince of Wales Bridge. Like most original structures, this bridge was designed by Henry Greenley. Unfortunately, its attractive lines have been spoilt by the addition of a concrete block walling. But perhaps with a little imagination, and some electronic assistance, we can see it as Greenley intended. Being double track, the railway can see some unusual workings. Here, Winston Churchill and Dr. Sin celebrate their 60th birthday with a parallel run. Beyond Palmarsh, the railway finally escapes from the houses into the open countryside. Overlooking Botolph's Bridge Road stands Lym Castle, where it's said Captain Howie, the railway's founder, used to stand and watch for the telltale puff of steam from the engine's whistles as they approached the road crossing. landscape changes to that of the rich farmland so often associated with this part of the country. The only onlookers are the occasional walker or the famous Romney Marsh sheep, as Hurricane gallops across the Willop to Burmarsh Road. Burmarsh Road is the second of 13 level crossings, and here we get the chance to see Samson in two liveries. Firstly, the Liverpool Garden Festival's red. And secondly, the current Great Eastern Blue. Our first stop is at Dymchurch. It's a typically traditional seaside town, with a small fairground and lots of sandy beaches, water sports and safe bathing. Alongside the sands, there are shops selling gifts and beachwear to the thousands of holidaymakers that visit the town each year. The station is about 4 minutes' walk from the beach, and during the summer it's a popular place for people to break their journey. At the booking office, a queue forms as the booking clerk sells tickets and gives advice.
£6.60.
Number 2, clear down, 14.29, thank you. Now,
while the station master checks that the line is clear before sending the next train on. Just off the end of the platform is a short siding controlled from this ground frame. Normally it's only used for engineers' trains, but once every 2 years Dr. Sin pays a visit to the Dymchurch Day of Sin and runs up and down alongside the crowded sports field. Thank you. Although all trains normally stop at Dymchurch, there is one exception, and that's the High Season Saturday's non-stop Kent Coast Express. From Dymchurch, the railway takes a nearly straight course to the next station at Jefferstone Lane. This small station once served the numerous holiday camps of St Mary's Bay. Now the camps are all closed and the station has few passengers. The Romney Marsh is crisscrossed with drainage canals. One of the largest is the new sewer, and the railway crosses it by means of the 60-foot single-span Collins Bridge. Very occasionally, the school's contract train is operated by steam engines instead of the usual diesels. Here, Northern Chief and Hercules bring the morning train around the Warren and on towards New Romney. New Romney is the railway's headquarters, and all the locomotives are kept there. The first person in is normally the firelighter. Having cleared out the remains of the old fires, he lays and lights new ones, so that steam is well on the way to being raised by the time the drivers arrive. In the locker room, the shed board lists the locomotives needed for the day. When sufficient steam has been raised, the locomotives are moved outside for final cleaning and preparation. A build-up of soot in the boiler tubes and flues can seriously impair steaming efficiency, and so they're regularly cleaned by using a metal tubing brush and a steam lance. As important as the steam locomotives are the railway's two diesels. These recent additions to the fleet see service nearly every day of the year, hauling both passenger and works trains. One thing the diesels don't need is coal. On an average day, a steam engine uses just under a quarter of a ton, and it all has to be loaded like this. The driver of Hercules is making an early morning inspection of work being carried out on his engine. There was no need to worry though. The work was completed in time for Hercules to take part in the Military Day Parade, as Britain's last surviving locomotive to have been used as part of an armoured train during World War II. To celebrate the event, this replica was constructed, and it's seen on patrol near Burma. With the locomotives now cold and watered, it's time for the first train of the morning to depart for Hythe. In the loco shed, Hurricane is getting a boiler washout. This happens every 5 or 6 days, and it stops the build-up of limescale. It's one of the jobs normally undertaken by the driver on his weekly workshop day. Outside the back of the shed, old sleepers, which are no longer fit for service, are being turned into kindling for the firelighter. Alongside the loco shed are the stores, which contain everything from nuts and bolts to complete spring sets. In the machine shop, the fitters manufacture and repair the unique items required to keep our locomotives, most of which are over 60 years old, in mainline condition. The carriage and wagon department have recently benefited from this lifting gantry, which can lift an entire coach to a comfortable working height. In another part of the building, a new aluminium open coach is under construction. Any major overhaul work is normally done during the winter, as it requires a locomotive to be stripped down to the bare necessities, as can be seen from these pictures of Green Goddess. Steam appears only occasionally during the winter, and the bug is an even rarer sight, especially when being used in revenue-earning service. The railway had been asked by the gas board to provide a train to transport gas pipes from the nearest road crossing to a site alongside the track at Greatstone. With both diesels otherwise committed, it was decided to use the bug for the job. The only other time steam is seen during the winter is when a locomotive is tested after repairs or overhaul. Here, Black Prince, minus her smoke deflectors, is in steam outside New Romney's shed. Unfortunately, the sun doesn't always shine in winter, and on some mornings, these are the types of scenes that greet the school train crew. The railway is very proud of its bad weather record of reliability, and everybody lends a hand to clear the snow, sometimes in absolutely dreadful conditions, such as here at Dymchurch, where the plate layers have to dig out the compacted ice and snow from the level crossings. The diesel is equipped with a snowplough, which was designed and built in our own workshops. Using a mixture of shovels and brooms, the snow and ice is removed from the crossing. Even when the snow stops falling, regular patrols are run to ensure that no drifts build up across the track. But now let's leave the snow behind and return to New Romney on a warm summer's day.
New Romney, this is New Romney. The light here, model exhibition, refreshment room and railway shop. The train at platform 2 is for Romney Saint and Dungeness.
3 adults, 2 children, the car park.
Unlike Dymchurch, both Hythe and New Romney have a computerised ticket system.
Roger, number 12 clear on the up, 12:23, and you had number 2 clear on the down, 12:31.
In 1990, the railway added this attractive canopy to the front of the Haywood Buffet. While upstairs, the ever-popular Toy and Model Museum continues to delight children of all ages. The centrepiece of the museum is this large HO gauge model railway. As well as the action on the main line, the layout has several push-button operated features, such as this turntable. At any one time, there can be as many as 30 trains in operation, and control is completely automatic. At intervals around the circuit, there are reed switches fitted between the rails, which are connected to relays in the control room. Attached to the front bogey of the leading coach or wagon in the train is a small magnet, and when the magnet passes over the reed switch, it operates a relay, which sends on the following train. And if you've ever wondered where trains disappear to when they enter the tunnels, then here's the answer. As well as the HO gauge, there's also a small G-scale layout, which is an ideal size for a garden railway. Alongside the railways are a superb collection of showcase models and toys. There's also a photographic display about the railway, and a small collection of historic posters. But now it's time to rejoin our train and continue our journey to Dungeness. On leaving New Romney, the railway tunnels under Littlestone Road before starting the long climb up to Half Mile Curve. The Romney ran parallel to the old Southern Railway New Romney branch. This standard gauge railway was connected to the main Ashford-Hastings line at Appledore. It closed to passengers in 1967, leaving the RH&DR as New Romney's only railway connection with the outside world. At Half Mile Curve, the two lines diverged. The New Romney branch took an inward path while the Romney turned to run parallel with the coast towards Greatstone. Big things were expected of Greatstone Station in the 1930s. Unfortunately, the new town by the sea never materialised, and when the station was taken over by the army in 1940, they turned it into a gun emplacement. Now, trains don't stop at Greatstone anymore. The only station between New Romney and Dungeness is here at Romney Sands. In the 1970s, a passing loop was installed so that a two-train operation could be run over the section. To ensure that only one train at a time is on each single line, the driver must be in possession of a tablet inscribed with the section details. Here, the driver of Hurricane accepts the New Romney to Romney Sands tablet and the driver of John Southland. The station is named after the adjacent Romney Sands holiday village, although for years it was known as Madison's after the old holiday camp that occupied the site. From Romney Sands, the railway runs behind walls and gardens with only an occasional glimpse of the sea. finally, at the pilot, the train leaves the houses behind and runs out across the shingle. Now there's only one more obstacle before the end of the line, and that's Britannia Points, where the loop on which Dungeness Station is built rejoins the main line. At first sight, Dungeness may seem a barren and desolate place, but in summer, when all the wild flowers are in bloom, it takes on an entirely different character. While we wait for the return train, there's always the lighthouse to climb, or perhaps the visitors' centre at the power station to see. Or maybe you might like to discover the remains of the old main line station, from where up until 1937 you could catch a train to Victoria. That line's just a memory now, but the Romney's still very much alive, and with your help it will be for many years to come.